go. Cueing both cameras. The go wasn't as smooth as it is sometimes gone, friends. You are listening to The Correct View. Sam I.B. DeGangi with The Media Speaks. The reason we're having more trouble cueing them is that the actual camera that we use for the show isn't being used. Why would that be? Because Christelle and I did, in fact, tie the knot, and we used the only very professional camera we have to film the wedding. And the person that does all of the band work, amazing video, Serpino, he actually went ahead and has is doing all the video editing on it. So we don't have the camera. What we do have is the live listeners here and our other camera here. I don't think it's HD. I'm not sure it is. Usually it is. If you're new to the show, yes, I just got married. No, I'm not going to talk about it all day because you don't know who I am and you don't care. What you do care about is BizPack Review Michael Dorshowitz. Is Trump right? Guess which rapists don't appear on the National Sex Offender Registry? And it's the exact ones he said. We'll get to that in a minute. But I want to mention this. Trump is in favor of two things. One of them may have been a joke. Dear God alive, I hope it was. How many of you remember that I said on air, and I got to interview Tyrell Ventura, Jesse Ventura's son, and he was wonderful towards us, and I hope to talk to him again. He was a great, great person to interview, and I think the show was made better by him being on it. I really do. His dad lost my vote when he started talking about trying to get Howard Stern as a running mate. Trump, and I perhaps heard it was a joke, I don't know, let me know if it was, wanted Oprah. I would rather eat a bowl full of live maggots while sitting on a toilet seat with fire ants covered in rubbing alcohol with a smoker nearby than have Oprah Winfrey anywhere near the White House. Hands down, absolutely not. I wouldn't want to be ambiguous. I can say this, if that was a joke, that's fine. It got everybody's attention, that's clever. You do realize, though, he wants to treat, I don't want to word this. He wants to treat people that are whistleblowers and heroes, like Edward Snowden, like they're traitors. Edward Snowden pointed out that the government was breaking the law. Edward Snowden did not break the law. An unjust law is just that. It's an unjust law. It should never have been there. That is not the same as treason, which would be perhaps what the Clinton administration did when they gave our nuclear trade secrets to China. Now that would be treason. Having said those two things, and unless he resends what he is saying on Snowden, I don't know that Trump can get my vote back. I cannot support someone that would treat whistleblowers that way. However, I will admit that if Rand Paul doesn't get the election, and if Trump gets it instead of him, that you get people are crazy. Yes, Trump is right. Trump is Trump will make a good president. He really will. He will. He'll make a good president, and I'll say that up front. Hillary will make a terrible president. Gary Johnson would make an amazing president. Rand Paul would make a very good president to the point where I would be willing to vote for Rand against Hillary because I don't believe that that's the lesser of two evils. I don't believe that Rand is evil. We disagree on some things. The flag, the whole flag scandal, for instance. But as it stands right now, Rand Paul or Gary Johnson, who I voted for last time, has my vote. But I like Trump. I listened to his whole speech that he gave in Phoenix, and I agreed with about 99% of what he said in that speech. The things that I don't agree with, he avoided like the plague, because I think there's other people that are conservative that are very bothered by his other beliefs. But he's been right. He's right on immigration. I like a lot that he wants to make it easier to get into the country legally, but he does not want to tolerate illegal immigration. I don't think that you should have to be very rich to get into the country like you do now. That shouldn't be the case. We need to get intelligent people here, not necessarily rich. But we don't need people climbing over the borders, the very worst of the worst, which is not all that's coming here. I know better. I've lived in apartment complexes where they had both legal and illegal immigrants in the building. They were all wonderful to me. That's not the point. The point is, there are a lot of terrible people coming into the country. And he's right on this. Everyone said how closed-minded he was. Well, listen to this. The National Database of Sex Offenders is missing one crucial sub-element of society. Illegal immigrants. In other words, if someone molests your kid and they're not in the country, they're not on the registry. CNN's John Walsh fought for years to get National Database for Sex Offenders, like the one who kidnapped and murdered his son, Adam Walsh. The results were the National Sex Offender Public Registry. There's only one problem. The registry only lists the names of offenders who are U.S. citizens. It doesn't include people who are living here illegally. This is from the Boston Globe. I love when people say I don't give any sources, and I don't like that guy because he disagrees with me. The Boston Globe is disagreeing with you if that's the case. Hundreds of immigrants convicted of sex crimes who should have been deported but instead were released in the United States because their homelands refused to take them back. They are convicted rapists, child molesters, and kidnappers, among the worst of the worst, as one law enforcement agency put it. Yet the Globe found that immigration officials have released them without making sure that they register with the local authorities as sex offenders. Does that make you feel great? It goes on, once U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement frees them, agency officials often lose track of the criminals, despite outstanding deportation orders against them. By law, police are supposed to investigate if such offenders fail to update their address within days of their release. But local officials said they did not learn that ICE had released the sex offenders until after the Globe inquired about their cases. In other words, what Donald Trump said was happening, and he got reamed for it, has just been confirmed as happening by the Boston Globe. How could a country that can put a Mars rover on Mars and send back pictures of ice crystals at a cost of $44 billion and not be able to track convicted sex offenders, especially illegal alien sex offenders? Walsh asked the CNN host Aaron Bernhardt. Trump was right. So there you go. David Lake will be very happy. Again, I'm not going to lie. I think he'll make an okay president. Certainly better than Jeb Bush. Certainly better than Rubio. Yeah. But he's not going to be the kind of man that we really need in other areas. That would be Rand Paul, who we're going to talk about here. Rand Paul vows to fight against gruesome Planned Parenthood. This is a mistake for Rand, and I will tell you why. I'm not in favor of funding Planned Parenthood from the federal government. I agree with Rand Paul 125% on this issue. The federal government has no business funding Planned Parenthood. However, I don't have a problem with states doing it. If that's what the states choose to do, that's why we have 50 states. That's what the Constitution says you're supposed to do. And Rand Paul would agree with me on that as well. We're in agreement. My question is a bigger one. First of all, we need to worry more about the people that are living here now in the country, more so than an issue that is as divisive as this, when he is at somewhere between 4 and 14%, and Trump is at 18 to 24%. Rand really needs to get moving on this. The chainsaw thing was brilliant. He's been very, very concise and very well-spoken in his interviews. He hasn't seemed as rigid as his father did, and I loved his father. I'm not saying anything bad. I'm just saying he seems much more, much less rigid, if I can speak today. This Planned Parenthood thing is turning a lot of people off who are against abortion, and let me tell you why. And I'm not going to say how I know, and you'll know why in a minute. But I'm a DJ in an adult club. but things that happen to them that do not involve sex, do not involve birth control, and do not involve abortions. Sometimes things come out of certain places and it shouldn't, and you need a doctor. And if you can't afford a doctor, then guess what? You go to Planned Parenthood. I know a lot of people who have gone there for medical procedures that they could not otherwise have afforded or would have gotten much worse. Do you realize if you have a toothache in this country today, you are damned? You're doomed. You're absolutely doomed. There's nowhere for you to go, especially if it's an impacted wisdom tooth. You are hosed. You just sit there and suffer. Planned Parenthood makes sure that that doesn't happen for women. The other issue is the idea of selling the body parts. It was legal to sell the tissue of aborted children for medical research if the mother signed off. Rand Paul, in my opinion, would be better off closing that law instead of trying to close Planned Parenthood. He would be better off saying that the federal government needs to stop funding all of these things and it needs to be turned over to the states. But he needs to avoid, and that's why you're listening to The Correct View, because I promise you this is correct. He needs to stop assuming that everybody that goes to Planned Parenthood is getting the coat hanger, because they're not. And he's going to alienate a lot of fair-minded voters if he doesn't realize that. Senator Rand Paul said, Steve Watson, InfoWars, Senator Rand Paul will push ahead with plans to defund abortion organization Planned Parenthood and stop the nonprofit from getting quite so many millions in federal funding. I think the time is now to discuss whether taxpayer dollars should be going to such a gruesome procedure, Paul noted in an appearance on Fox News Sunday. People are outraged by this, and I think the American people deserve and want to vote on it. Yes, but it's going to be very hard for a woman to vote against the only medical doctor she can afford, even if she is a strict Christian pro-life Republican. They still get women issues, too. That's all I'm going to say. Rand, it's Trump is mowing over you, and I want you in the White House. So please, please, would you do something other than this? Moving on, the persecution of Christians is intensifying as anti-Christian hatred sweeps the entire world. And this is from Michael Snyder at the end of The American Dream. You can read his prologue on this. Listen to this. This is what's going on in the world to Christians. Iraq. Eliza Griswold is the author of a book called The Tenth Parallel, Dispatches from the Fault Line Between Christianity and Islam, and have spent a great deal of time examining the demise of the Christian faith in the heart of the Middle East. The following is an excerpt from a recent piece that he did for the New York Times. Recently, ISIS posted videos delineating the second-class status of Christians in the caliphate. Those unwilling to pay a jizya tax, J-I-Z-Y, they said it, not me. And that's exactly what I think of it. Come on now. Or to convert would be destroyed, the narrator warned, as the videos culminated in the now infamous scenes of Egyptian and Ethiopian Christians in Libya being marched to the beach and beheaded, their blood running into the turf. Did you see the video? I watched it today prior to doing this report. It's as terrible as any beheading video you're going to see. I'm not going to promote violence like that, but it's going on all over the... Now, if this was happening, I'm not saying I want it to happen to anybody. I don't. If it was happening to Jews, or if it was happening... Remember what Bill Clinton did when Slobodan Milosevic started slaughtering and removing people of moving minorities from the area, the massive war and all the Kosovo dittos, people calling Rush, remember that? Well, it's happening to Christians. Nobody really gives a damn, do they? It's that the future of Christianity in the region of its birth is now uncertain. In other words, even if everything that they say about Islam is true, Christians were there first, because Christianity predates Islam, and this is the birthplace of it. How much longer can we flee before we and the other minorities become a story in the history books, says Neri Kino, a journalist and founder of the advocacy group for Demand for Action. It says, according to a Pew study, Christians are now faced with religious persecution more than at any other time in their history. Kenya, the place of Obama's birth, no surprise there since he's been the worst president ever for Christians. And this is in Africa. It's from a CNN piece. He doesn't give any sources. CNN, never hear of it. In April last year, hundreds of students at Garissa University in northern Kenya came under attack when Al-Shabaab and militants from across the border in Somalia raided dormitories at the college, separating Christian students from their Muslim classmates. The raiders killed 147 and wounded dozens more. Today, the university stands empty. To quote Michael Savage, 147 people killed from the religion of peace. Christians in northeastern Kenya have come under repeated attacks from Al-Shabaab militants. At Sunday Mass in Garissa's cathedral, listen to this. You want to talk about a hero? Don't tell me about some guy that used to be a guy in the Olympics and now he dresses in a dress and now he's a hero. No, you want to hear about a hero? I'll give you a hero. At Sunday Mass in Garissa's cathedral, Our Lady of Consolation, great name for it. The benches are full. The congregation is praying under armed guard, but they're praying nonetheless. Each Sunday brings with it new threats from Al-Shabaab. Garissa's Christians are told that if they worship there, you'll die. Worship here, you'll die. One of those attending Sunday Mass, Patrick Gitau, tell us that despite the risks, every Sunday I am here, it is my cathedral. Yes, I'm here, and I was baptized in this church. God, now that's a hero. Put him on a Wendy's box. 3. India. Now, I didn't know about this. I used to always say a joke that you don't see the Hindus out slaughtering people. I was wrong. And this, out of the entire list, don't zone out, this floored me. I heard nothing of this. It isn't just Muslims that are viciously persecuting Christians. In India, radical Hindus are regularly conducting violent attacks against Christians and churches. And, the Evangelical Fellowship of India has reported a violent attack against Christians in the country that was committed earlier this month when over 200 Hindu radicals stormed a Protestant church in the town of Atangal, Kerala, beating up the pastor and some of the worshippers and breaking the altar. Look, the Hindus are usually pretty peaceful. I mean, most of the wars going on in the world right now have to do with either Russia or America overstepping their bounds, and they both do it quite often. Look at my 4th of July report if you don't believe me on that. Tons of sources there as well. Or it has to do with Islam not getting along with its neighbors, and that's usually what causes most of the hot spots all over the world. Yeah, you've got tin horn dictators like Kim Jong-un or something, but for the most part, a little bit of greed from America sending all of our jobs to China, so now we have to deal with their insanity because they make everything. But Hindus aren't normally causing any trouble. Unless you are Pakistan, which just will not leave India alone, Hindus don't normally bother anybody. When did this start? EFI shared the news with FIDES, F-I-D-E-S, it might be FIDES, news agency, reporting that the attack took place on June 14th. The radicals apparently shouted slogans that say, "Hail Mother India," during the attack, which was broken up when police arrived. How in the hell does Christianity bother Mother India? Makes no sense at all. Excuse me, I was thirsty. Pakistan. Oh, we know that. We know this is coming. This is what's happened recently. May 24th, a Christian man, it was a Sunday, in the Sanda neighborhood of Lahore, was accused of blasphemy when some Muslims saw him burning newspapers that reportedly contained Arabic verses in the Quran. Why? If you are not supposed to burn any images in the Quran, or any text from the Quran, why are you putting it in a newspaper? Because what do people use newspapers for when they're done reading them? Bird cages, litter boxes. I'm a Christian, and it never crossed my mind. I burn newspaper to get fire started all the time. Do you have any idea how many Christian verses I have burned in my life? They're in the repository at the local paper here, in the local section, every day. Not to mention the Sunday edition of the paper, which has all the church listings. I've probably burnt the whole Bible in the course of my life. This is ridiculous. What kind of bonehead would call somebody blasphemous for burning a newspaper? And if you can't burn the words, then why would you put them in a newspaper? I mean, this is stupidity at its height here. It says, after the accusation, a Muslim mob caught the Christian, severely beat him, and even attempted to set him on fire. What you do then is you make sure you write the Quran, like a tattoo on your arm, and they can't ever set you on fire because they can't, see? Uh-huh, that's why you're listening, staying one step ahead here at the Correct Views. A few months earlier, another Muslim mob burned a Christian couple alive inside of a kiln after they too were accused of insulting Islam. Why would anybody insult Islam? They're just the kind of people that burn a couple alive in a kiln. Why? Where did the insult come from? Why? Who knows? We should be thanking them, I guess. The Christian youth named Hamayun Masiyah, sorry if I ruined your name, said to be mentally unstable, was imprisoned and charged under Section 295B of Pakistan's Penal Code, which prohibits the desecration of the Quran. After the attack on the Christian youth, the Muslim mob, reportedly thousands of them, rampaged through the neighborhood and set fire to Christian homes and a church. Like, they even knew who this guy was. They got their home burned down because somebody else burnt the Quran. That's an understanding religion. Why would anybody speak badly against it? Christians in the region were attacked and most fled the region. Some of the mob was armed with gunshots. That's just an excuse to steal is what it is. Nigeria, we know that's a hellhole too. More than 2,000 people died there. Where's the global media for this, it asks. Of course, Boko Haram did it, killing over 10,000 Nigerians, including thousands of Christians. 10,000 people. These are Adolf Hitler numbers, for those of you that don't know history. This year alone, over 2,000 people have been killed as a result of the group's attacks. 750,000 have fled their homes. Again, an excuse to steal from them in the name of Islam. Which makes very good Islamists sick to their stomach, as it does me, who is loud Islamic, I can tell you. Earlier in July, Muslim extremists ravaged northeastern villages, killing 9 villagers, burning down 32 churches and about 300 homes. Well, that sounds peaceful to me. China, we already know how they treat Christians. It's legal. Oh, it is legal here. No, it is not legal there. The Chinese government has been brutally persecuting Bible-believing Christians for decades. But this year, things have been taken to a new level. This is from the Washington Beacon article. And I do impersonations of everyone. People do impersonations of me. It's fine. Oh, it is fine. No offense taken. The CCP considers the rising popularity of Christianity as a threat to its dominance, China Aid said, and has used aggressive measures to intimidate members. Well, you know, it might be against your dominance for people to realize that you're supposed to love your brother, not run them over with tanks in Tiananmen Square. You know, I guess it could be a threat if you're somebody that likes to run people over with tanks. The Chinese government's persecution campaign included forced demolition of churches and crosses, detonation and imprisonment of pastors, church members on criminal charges were being brought up, forcing churches into bankruptcy by taking their property, imposing fines, manipulating state-run media to label house churches cults, and more. Reading it in your house, you're a cult. Reading it in a church is fine, but we'll take your church. That's wonderful. There's more on that in the article here. Nepal, number 7, they banned people from converting to Christianity. So I guess you have to lie and say you've always been a Christian. It makes no sense. Christianity is not recognized as a religion, unlike Hinduism, Buddhism, or of course Islam. Hence, churches cannot be registered as a legal body and we cannot buy property, and we're severely handicapped by this. Again, mass refusal is the way to resist these kinds of things, and that's why I promote that kind of thing in this country, and you'll see more on that in a minute. Hey, Italy. Normally you wouldn't think of Italy. Of course, Rome, for the Lady Gaga fans, would be the Catholic Church's capital. Normally you wouldn't think of Italy as a place where Christians would be persecuted, but thanks to the Islamic immigration, that is rapidly changing. Again, it's usually radical Islams not wanting to get along with its neighbors. How do you think Syria and Egypt became Islamic? We all know that. We see the pyramids. We know that Egypt wasn't always Islamic. How did that happen? Because if you didn't convert, they'd burn you alive. That's how it's the only way they can get anybody to convert to it. Unless they're like 12-year-old girls that are finding it on Twitter or Tumblr. I don't think anybody's on Tumblr but me. Accounts of Muslim immigrants taunting and even assaulting Christians in Italy are increasing. Earlier this year, a crucifix was violently destroyed in close proximity to a populated mosque. Oh, don't hurt the Quran, but we can ruin the crucifix. And the statue of the Virgin Mary was destroyed and urinated on by North Africans in Italy. Oh, well, why do we treat the Quran so badly? They're so respectful. 9. Canada. I didn't know this either. This was the second surprise. On May 26th, a 22-year-old man of Muslim background, was charged with alleged hate crimes committed against the St. Catherine of Siena Church and its neighboring elementary school in Masugi, Ontario. Ipakwa Hassan faces 5 counts of mischief and $5,000 in fines. On May 20th, the Sacred Heart of Jesus statue that stands in front of the church was covered in black paint, and the fingers of the outstretched were broken off, and they said that there is no Jew God. And someone drew a face that said Jesus on it, and it's the fourth time the church was targeted. Again, I'm going to say I don't think that's all of Canada. I haven't heard a lot of that from Canada. It sounds like a small group of extremists, but we all know how that grows, too, so it was worthy of mention for that reason. And 10, no surprise here at all. I'm going to read the whole section before we move on. The U.S., obvious, I mean completely obvious to anybody in the country at all. And I went to junior high with Marilyn Manson. I support his right to do what he does. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the all-out mockery of all things Christian that aren't done musically, but are done as in something you are supposed to accept as normal. It says if Christians stay in their homes and don't say anything, normally they don't get physically persecuted in the U.S. But in recent years, it says there have been an increasing number of incidents where street preachers and others that do try to actively influence the culture are violently assaulted. This is one incident in Seattle. 2 street preachers were brutally beaten, punched, and kicked by a crowd at a gay pride festival in Seattle, and the entire melee was captured on video. That's another thing. I've said it 100 times. I have no problems with gay people. I really don't. If the church wants to marry you, then so be it. If the church doesn't want to, then they should be able to tell you to get out of their church and never come back. I'm like every other red-blooded guy. You show me 2 women and somebody will show you me watching. Sin or not, I get it. But this militant, hateful side of homosexuality that is just doing this kind of thing. This is, I think, what the Bible warned about more than the normal deviancy, which I think most of us are guilty of. It says the preachers were holding up signs saying, "Repent or die, and Jesus saves from sin." No, repent or else, I'm sorry. The video shows a group of people initially screaming and threatening the men during Pride Fest at the Seattle Space Needle. You don't have a straight parade. Why would you have a gay parade? I wouldn't want to go to a straight parade. If you're gay or if you're straight, be in the parade. Why are you celebrating your sexuality in the street like a dog? I just don't get it. I'm straight. Should I go having a parade telling everyone? It makes no sense to me. Television station Como KOMO reported that some of the attackers belonged to the group called No Hate. No Hate attacks somebody. That's like Islam, the religion of peace attacking someone. It's like a Dundee report. It says a group of women tried to steal their signs but were unsuccessful. No Hate, though. The video shows a group of men grabbing onto one of the preacher's signs and dragging him to the ground. At some point, he was punched in the back of the head a number of times and can be seen kicking the man. And again, it quotes here John chapter 15 where it says, if the world hates you, know that it hated me first. We're seeing it all around us, friends. And I wanted to give some time to that because it's been rather dreadful. And I've sort of been zipping through my reports lately because I've been planning the wedding. So you guys are going to get a nice long show today. Infringers spend more on content than non-infringers. Customers want content on demand at prices that make sense. Christelle, your camera has ding-dinged. If it does cut off, make sure you go to themediaspeaks.com. The live stream is always there. Timothy Geiner, Tech Dirt. We've argued for quite a long time. Now she knocked over the tripod, but that's okay. We'll just keep going while she readies it again. Because let's face it, if you're actually watching the show a half hour into it, well, hey, baby, how do you think I'm sexy, baby? If you're a guy, hi. No. Otherwise, you're probably just watching anyway, so you're fine. We've argued for quite a long time that treating pirates like criminals instead of potential customers is a massive mistake for a whole host of reasons. There is the futility of the legal game, for instance, as well as the possible relations nightmare for going after the public, even the infringing public can create. But the best reason to not treat infringers, that would be people like me, that take copywritten material, like criminals, is because they're often the best actual customers of content as well. In study after study, it's shown that a person who engages in some infringement spends more total money on movies, music, and video games than someone who gets everything legit. Pirates, arg mighty, that would be me. Scurvy-laden bastards as they may be. Happen to be Creative Industries' best customers. So what does that mean? Why are you listening to the correct views? That didn't make any sense. That was a very wordy paragraph. What is he saying? People like me, that steal music, often end up spending more on things related to it than those that just buy it. For instance, how many of you, and I, if you haven't, do so, bought the Skinny Puppy CD Weapon? When it came out, I spun the hell out of that CD, especially Paragon. Had it been a vinyl CD, there would have been a hole in it. A vinyl record, I should say. There would have been a hole in it. I downloaded the CD. I supported that in clubs and still play it, even now, but not as much as I was. I laid on it for a year. Christelle, lo and behold, went to the Skinny Puppy concert, bought a Skinny Puppy t-shirt, drove all the way to PA to do it. They made more off of you listening than probably just bought the CD by itself. And it happens all the time. I watch pirated movies all the time. Almost all my free money is spent on travel. I went to see Judas Priest at Rock on the... Christelle went to see Judas Priest at Rock on the Range and Cincinnati. I went to see them in Cincinnati. I downloaded Redeemer of Souls. I do want to get it because I like the artwork. But I downloaded it. Guess what? Played the hell out of it in the clubs. Bought a t-shirt when I went. It's absolutely true. Share your story with me if you can, if you're the same way. Also, you don't know if you are, like, you go to YouTube and someone posts a movie. If you watch it, did you pirate it? You shouldn't with all the ads you get. The other day on BitTorrent, I got ads while my BitTorrent was coming down. So I'm not understanding how Hollywood is losing money on this. Even BitTorrent has ads. It says, as it turns out, it's no different in Australia, where a recent government study bore out the same conclusion. Infringers spend more money on content than content saints. Consumers who flirt with the morally ambiguous line of content consumption, that is pirating, spend more money according to the survey released by the Australian Department of Communications. Over a three-month period among the respondents aged 12 and over, the survey found that those who consumed a mixture of copyright infringing and non-infringing content spent on average in Australian money $200 on music, $118 on video games, $92 on movies, $33 on TV content, and on and on and on and on. I can give you a bunch of numbers and put you to sleep. The point is, you're not here to sleep. You're here to know that the pirates are not hurting things the way you think that they are. The trouble is, people are spending it in ways that are different now that we are in the internet age. That's what it is. The money is still being spent. You either liked the Skinny Puppy CD or you didn't. And if you didn't, you're probably deaf. Friends, listen to the correct views. I've got just a few more stories to get to. I'm deliberately giving you a longer show because I've been rushing them again for the wedding. Brought to you by StickerJunkie.com. Look at these. This is what Sticker Junkie does. Passing Time is the band I'm in. If you want one of these, get a hold of me at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. You'll get one. Who does it? Nobody does it better than Sticker Junkie. So when you go there, tell David Lake that you heard about it here in the comment line or in your order, and you're going to get a discount. Also, check out the works of Mike McLaughlin. You can see him on Facebook.com. Look him up. Say, Sam said you're an amazing writer. Let me see what you got. You will be delighted that you did. Last Saturday, since I was, for God's sake, get me to the church on time, since I was at the wedding, I didn't get to do news from the science front. And for those of you that care, before we get into three dumdies, I've got three dumdies tonight. I didn't get to news from the science front, so I'm going to give you the story that should have been on there Saturday when I was doing my I do-zes. Large Hadron Collider discovers new pentaquark particle. There is no way that we could, see and could do something else other than the addition of this new particle. Basically, the particle is, they knew it existed, they simply didn't have a way in which to prove it. And thanks to the Hadron Collider they have, many people believe that in the long run this collider could be very, very dangerous in terms of black holes getting out of control. If you don't know why, it's because they create little mini black holes and big bangs when they do this. And it is possible that they could do it one time too many, according to some scientists. Well, listen to this anyway. Scientists at the Large Hadron Collider have announced the discovery of a new particle called a pentaquark. Side note, how many of you here, when you hear Super Collider, you hate it, because it was also the name of the worst Megadeth album ever. Sorry, love you, Megadeth. That album sucked! It was first predicted to exist in the 1960s, but much like the Higgs-boson particle before it, the pentaquark eluded science for decades until its detection at the LHC. The discovery, which amounts to a new form of matter, that's right, another form of the hard stuff, was made by the Hadron Collider's LHCb experiment. Or for those of you like me that believe that the universe is a simulation, it's a new form of matter in our realm. Anyway, it says the findings have been submitted by the journal Physical Review Letters. In 1964, two physicists, Murray Gell-Mann and George Zwigg, independently proposed the existence of the subatomic particles known as quarks. They theorized, it says, that these key properties of the particles known as Byrons and Meissons were best explained if they were in turn made up of other constituent particles. Zwigg coined the term ACEs for the three new hypothesized building blocks, but it was Gell-Mann's name Quark that stuck. This model also allowed the other quark states, such as pentaquark. This purely theoretical particle was composed of four quarks and an anti-quark, that is antimatter or ordinary quark, which I don't believe that that's what that is, but I don't want to get too sidetracked here. New states. During the mid-2000s, several teams claimed to have detected pentaquarks, but their discoveries were subsequently undermined by other experiments. Well, guess what, friends? We found it. It says there's been a long, long history of them trying to. It says they've examined all possibilities for these signals, and they conclude that they can only be explained by the pentaquark states, which the states have been named PC4450+ and PC4380+, for those of you that know those naming conventions. New form of matter discovered here, and we're going over here at the correct views. I think it's kind of interesting. It said the pentaquark is not just any particle. It represents a way to aggregate quarks, namely the fundamental constituents of ordinary protons and neutrons, in a pattern that has never been observed before in over 50 years of experimental searches. Studying its properties allow us to understand better how ordinary matter, the protons and neutrons from which we are all made, is constituted. In other words, what everything is made out of is better understood now. And friends, for those of you that like the dummies, you're going to be so very, very happy because we have not one, not two, but three. That's right, three dummies. What's our dummy music? Oh, yes. Dum, dum, dumdy, dum, 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 dum. Three dumdies. That's because I have so many dumdies to go out. And I'm not going to be able to do them all on one show. So I did three here right in a row. They all tie together, so it works in well that way. Also, we have to mail both dunce caps out at once because Christelle, the behind-the-scenes queen before the wedding, has managed to forget to mail the dunce cap and not plug in the microphone for the last show. Two huge errors which you never see from the behind-the-scenes queen. But of course, now that she is married, I'm sure she'll be back to her normal plugging and mailing self. So we may mail them both at once. If you happen to have seen the Dunce Cap of the Month award and you think I didn't get my cap, he's lying, don't worry, it's coming. Video, the push to make husbands and wives illegal. I had to do that today, had to. Bill would ban husband and wife from being used in federal law because they discriminate against gay people. That's like saying if you're not a horse, then using the word horse in front of dogs could be offensive. You are a husband or a wife. It is a bill that they are trying to move through Congress to ban husband and wife. What other dummies do you want? Male feminists. Men who enjoy barbecues are oppressing women. Barbecues reinforce gender roles and the strain of unintentional masculine cliché. I don't know. I guess usually you do see a guy cooking. In my first marriage, my ex cooked as often as I did on the grill. And with Christelle, the entire time we've been together, usually she grills or we do it together because we like our steaks slightly different. Never have I... This is the kind of thing where you can tell you're being led astray by the, what I like to call the division brigade of the country. They could point to something that's an absolute non-issue and make it sound like it's racist or sexist or some kind of ist, because the feminazis, among others, love to do this. It's practically a pillar of the Democratic Party today, which is a shame. They used to be a good party. This makes no sense. For one thing, one of the reasons that women don't do barbecues in some events is because if they're all made up and the smoke gets in their hair and runs their makeup, they're prone not to do it. And since barbecues are often done on holidays, and women tend to get dressed up on holidays, they choose not to barbecue. It has nothing to do with sexism or her ability to cook. It makes no sense at all. This is one of the dumbest articles I've ever read, which isn't surprising since it's from Slate. Again, that Paul Joseph Watson wrote about the Slate article. I'm not talking about him. We like him. Slate writer and male feminist Jacob Brogan thinks that men should feel guilty for enjoying the inherently misogynistic pastime of grilling food at a barbecue. Again, I have to remind you, this is not an article out of The Onion. It's not a parody article. This is yet another illustration of the everything is sexist, racist mental illness that has infected public discourse thanks to social justice warriors. In an article, this is subtitled, "I'm Feminist, I'm a Dude, and I Hate That I Love to Grill," Bogan writes about how he's uncomfortable with the pleasure I take in something so conventionally masculine. At such moments, I get the sense that I've fallen into a social trap, one that reaffirms gender roles. Oh my, my, my. I've spent years trying to undo. Oh, the whole business feels retrograde, a relic of some earlier, less inclusive era. Ever see the Jerky Boys? I'm Thal Rosenberg. Oh, please don't beat me. He reminds me of that character. I feel so bad about barbecuing. It left me in a pile of my own piss and blood. Brogan worries, for those of you that don't know the quote, that made no sense. Look up Jerky Boys. Brogan worries that he is shoving others out of the way because it makes me feel like a man. and that barbecues reinforce the strain of unconventional masculine cliché, while TV commercials that depict only men behind the grill allow guys to confirm their masculinity while excluding women. Why don't you just ask the lady if she wants to cook? Hey, honey, I'm going to make my food. You want to make one? Would that make you feel better? Oh, I bet it would. Would you like some warm milk in a cup? As far as I can tell, this is not an elaborate joke. Brogan actually thinks that men grilling food is inherently misogynistic, that is anti-women for you Ketcha fans. He continues arguing that the masculine connotations of grilling are actually specific, and hence culturally constructed, and that this, along with aggressive bro culture and lack of children care support, has led to fewer head chef roles for women in professional kitchens. The association of grilling and masculinity partakes of a similar logic, Brogan writes. Unlike most other traditional feminine forms of domestic cooking, grilling typically happens outside and hence in the public sphere. The particularly masculine quality of grilling may derive in part from the old public-private gender split. In a sense, it means that the women should cook in the home, but not outside. This is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Someone wrote, "Stop ordering meat well done." That comes back from a history of whites giving blacks spoiled meat, so they have to cook it to death to avoid illness. If you eat it meat well done, you are racist. That's right, nothing to do with taste. It's because I knew it. I'm like a history freak. I had absolutely no idea that they did that. I'm not surprised. I think slavery was dreadful, but I didn't know that. I ain't my medium. What's that mean? I'm a dinosaur? Ridiculous. All right, friends, the last of the dumbdy of the day. Washington Post columnist, air conditioning is sexist. The mainstreaming of lunacy accelerates. This is also from PJ Dub. According to the Washington Compost, thank you, Rush, columnist Petula Dvorak, the latest example of the evil patriarchy trying to oppress women in the workplace comes in the form of air conditioning. Yes, air conditioning. What's interesting, I was very happy that the house I bought, we're getting it fixed up to rent, has air conditioning in the lower level, and I was so happy that it worked. Imagine what a sexist I am. Then again, I could have bought a new air conditioner, and that would have made me more sexist. But I don't have the money for a new one, so it could have been a used one, and I would have been the same sexist? I don't know. After talking to female office workers, PJ Dub writes, in downtown Washington, Dvorak comes to the conclusion that cool AC temperatures present the gender divide, thermostat edition. Since women tend to wear less clothes in the summer, they are more likely to complain about feeling cold at work. Dvorak talks to a number of ladies who express their displeasure about freezing in the office. In other words, Dvorak thinks that women are too stupid to know when to put clothes on. That's what it says. If you know that you work in an office that has the same temperature all year, then why would you wear summer clothes to work? That makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. Second of all, a lot of this is caused by things like smoking. Christelle, unfortunately, smokes like a chimney. And we went to a bowling alley about 2 weeks ago, and there were about 10, 15 people in there, men, women, children, elderly. Everybody was in tank tops, shirts, or a short sleeve shirt, tank top, or shorts, and nothing else, except Christelle, who had a windbreaker, who had a hoodie on. Why? Because she smoked her circulatory system away, and she's not that big to begin with. That is different from being too stupid to know that you work in an office. Why would you buy summer clothes for an office job? Yeah, when I worked in an office, and thank God I don't now, but I mean, it is still relevant now. I wear long sleeves often to work and just roll them up and long pants. Why? Even if I was allowed to wear shorts, I might, but I probably would keep the long sleeve element. Because it's about 70 or so degrees where I work. If you come into the club that I work, weighing 95 pounds in a miniskirt, knowing you're going into air conditioning. That is not sexist. You have a pumpkin for a head. Says everything is set at 70 degrees for those testosterone-toting people, one woman told Dvorak, explaining how frustrating it is to put on a pretty summer outfit and then get hit with a blast of cold. Then don't put on the pretty summer outfit, especially if you're a feminist, because some guy might think you're pretty, and then you're going to think he's a rapist, you're going to call him sexist, and you're going to get him fired anyway, so you might as well wear a burqa, you feminist Nazi! Meanwhile, all of the men who spoke to Dvorak said that they were comfortable with the temperature. Dvorak also blames men for AC setting in all female-centric offices. That's right, my friends. Air conditioning is another big sexist plot, writes Dvorak, whose solution is to turn the temperature up and make men wear shorts. I personally would love to wear shorts to work. I've got no problem with that at all. I don't think women should be allowed to wear shorts to work if men can't. That makes us fine with me. You want equal treatment? I'll give you equal treatment. Come boil with me. Does anyone else find it ironic that feminists are accusing men of secretly stacking the deck against women in order to get them to put on more clothes? Asked Stephen Crowder. Wouldn't it, now best line of the whole article, don't zone out, best line of the whole article. Wouldn't it be more reasonable to assume that men would be more likely to crank up the heat to get women to strip down into tiny dresses? First step, set the thermostat at 91 degrees. Second step, pitch casual bra and panty Friday. Now see, that there is logic biting you in the ass. It just completely destroyed Dvorak's whole article in one paragraph. Good job, Stephen Crowder. What's interesting is that Dvorak acknowledges that women were able to wear lighter clothing in the summertime while men continue to wear suits all year round, and they usually have no choice. Gosh, it's almost as if the people wearing heavier clothing might be warmer than the women in linen dresses would be. Obviously, this must be some tool of the evil patriarchy. I hate suits. Yeah, the only reason I wore a dress coat and a tie, I was just going to wear a black shirt, a black silk shirt, and a pair of black silk pants for the wedding. But we got the idea to dance out because we had a very orthodox-rooted, it wasn't an orthodox wedding, but a very orthodox-rooted, a lot of Russian and Greek orthodoxy in it. A lot of it was very serious because that's important to me. And I wanted to incorporate elements of fun, and part of it was taking my tie off and swinging it around. I hate ties. That's the only reason I wore the damn tie. So if the feminists want to get rid of suits, you can count me in on that. I hate them. It makes men look like boxes. It's ridiculous. It's the ugliest thing I've ever seen. What the hell good is a tie? It's a great way to lose a fight. It says, people often ask me why I don't just ignore these kinds of stories and concentrate on bigger issues. The problem is that the rhetoric is no longer confined to radical leftists with Tumblr blogs. It's being parroted to major news outlets all over. So friends, there you go. You got three dumdies of the day, and I'm back. You got a nice long show, damn near an hour. Now somebody will complain that I went too long, because no matter what you do, you're wrong. It's the feminist way, I don't know. Friends, you're listening to The Correct Views. Thank you for doing so. Good night. God bless. If you want to donate to the show, you can do so at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. Every penny that you give to me goes towards a better show. Make sure you go to themediaspeaks.com, look up the work of Kyle Court, D-Lake, and myself. And if you're still listening to this, are you still listening? If you are, go to Change Taxi and say, I heard about you on The Correct Views. Leave that as a comment there, and then let me know at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com, and I'll promote your favorite charity for the next month. That's what you get for listening so long. Good night, friends. God bless. That show was forever. I didn't think it was going to go that long. I really didn't. Oh, it's still on. Well, that's fine. It was a long show. I don't mind doing a long show.